I'm delighted to introduce Helen Mason. We've known each other for many, many years, and I'll just keep on talking while she gets mic'd up for the camera. And just waste a bit more time. So Helen is an expert in atomic physics and an international expert on the sun. Brackets, that means she's really very, very clever. I'm just normal. You're already here now, Helen.
I'm ready.
Ready to go.
Oh, okay, so you finished the intro. Sorry, I thought you were going to say a few more nice things about me. Ian and I were at university together many years ago, Queen Mary College. So, great, good. Well, I'm very happy to be here. So, I'm pleased that we've got a little bit of the solar daytime astronomy in here as well, I'm sure. How many of you do solar daytime astronomy? Ah, quite a few. Yeah. Well, today, we had a few sunspots. Somebody said this morning when they came in, oh, there's a whole cluster of sunspots there in the center of the sun. I said, ah, ha, 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 yeah, April the 1st. And they said, no, go and have a look. And actually, there are. So, brilliant. Okay, well, like all research, I've got a research group, not actually here at the Institute of Astronomy, but at the Department of Applied Maths, where we also do a little bit of astronomy down there. And most astronomy, most research is a collaborative thing. So I want to acknowledge the colleagues that have worked with me, my students and my postdocs who have worked with me and have helped me to provide the research that I'm going to talk to you a little bit about today. All things are teams. We work in the space, we work in teams. I've had a fantastic life in solar physics. I really have. I've been a part of many missions. So I've worked on Skylab, Solar Maximum Mission, Space Shuttle. And at the moment, we have a golden age of solar physics because we've had so many fantastic observatories available to us in the past couple of decades. And it's almost overwhelming. Ian was talking about the data and all the rest of it. And it's almost overwhelming the amount of information that we've had available to us. So I'm going to try and say a little bit about what we're doing with that information. It's only scratching the surface, really, or peeking under the frontiers of science. But here, before I start, here is an image from SDO of the sun today. And as you can see, we do have an active region here in the center of the sun. So this is where the sunspots are. This is an image from the Solar Dynamics Observatory. The sun is not of course, blue, but here we've got an image in the ultraviolet. So we can make it any color we like. We can make it blue. I prefer pink, to be honest, but they've chosen blue. And we can also see some dark areas, coronal hole areas. But here we can see quite a nice active region right in the center of the sun. So if we think about our sun in the more normal way in which we see it, we can see these sunspots. The Earth is about the size of this sunspot here. The sun is huge. Everything that happens on it is amazing as far as I'm concerned, but also very difficult for us to explain. It is a star like many of the other stars that we see in the sky, but it's a star that's very close to us, and that means we can see a huge amount of detail on it, and we really can't hypothesize about you know, what's happening there in the sense that we can see what's happening there. So we consider it to be a real physics laboratory, very close to us. There are many things we still can't understand about the sun, but if we, you know, and our thinking is if we can't understand this sun, our nearest star, it makes it difficult to understand some of the more distant stars and astrophysical objects that we see. That's my reasoning anyway. So let me start with, and as Ian did, a little bit of a historical perspective. I hope the movies are going to work. We did test them out beforehand. Yes, well done. Galileo, one of my favorite astronomers. Why? Because he lives in Italy. He lived in Italy, and Italy is one of my favorite places to visit, where the sun shines constantly. Not only did Galileo point his telescope at the at the planets at the night time, but he also was interested in the sun, and in particular in sunspots. And these are his actual drawings of the sun. Projected, of course, don't look at the sun. Project an image or use a special solar telescope. This is, of course, he was always in trouble for his scientific theories, and he was kept under house arrest for the confirming what Copernicus had proposed, that in fact the Earth went around the sun. He got into trouble also with the sun because of these spots he assigned to the sun, and all astrophysical objects were supposed to be perfect. So he was in a lot of trouble. And I've been to his house. His house is actually owned by a Chetri observatory. We've been there quite frequently. And that's the view from his window. So in case you're feeling sorry for him, don't feel too sorry for him. Also, in addition to a fantastic view, he had a full wine cellar. So, these sunspots indicate how active the sun is, and as probably most of you know, it has a cycle of activity approximately 11 years, and at the moment we're in quite a quiet phase, which is why it's surprising to see any sunspots at all. The number of sunspots will indicate from the amount of activity whether we're going to have solar flares, solar explosions, coronal mass ejections coming from the sun. The more sunspots there are, the more likely we are to have features coming from the sun, the more likely these are to interact with the Earth's environment and cause beautiful northern lights. In fact, the solar wind can also cause this, and that's why at the moment, even though the sun is not very active, we are still getting quite a fantastic display of northern lights. Who's seen the northern lights? Grrr. I haven't seen them yet. So I'm really, you know, it's on my list, to-do list. I've got to keep going for a while longer. Here we can just see the number of sunspots as a function of year, 1900 to 2000, and we can see this sequence. Now, solar physics is enormous in its remit, so I'm going to focus in today, and I'm going to focus in on active regions and solar flares and tell you a little bit about what we've learned about that. But before I do, I'm going to think about another very famous astronomer. Of course, this guy was not just an astronomer. He was a famous mathematician. He did absolutely everything. He built the telescope, reflecting telescope, himself. And when people asked, why did you do that yourself? He said, well, if I had waited for someone else to do it, it never would have been done. An amazing guy. Not only did he investigate gravity and the laws of gravity, but he also studied the nature of light and realized that white light is made up of the colors of the rainbow. He had a few arguments with people. Science is always about arguing. You propose a theory, someone else proposes a contra theory, you debate and argue and you look at the evidence. So he had a few discussions, and I think at the end of the day both he and Huygens were right in what they suggested, but I won't go into the details there. So we can get the rainbow colours from the white light, but more interestingly, if we use a spectrometer, we can get the spectral lines. Now these provide a huge amount of information for us about the distant objects. We've been to the moon, we've got a little bit of moon dust back. We can't so easily go to the sun, pick a little bit of sun, or go to the stars and pick a little bit of stars. We've been to Mars, yeah, with a robot, but and picked a little bit of Mars. But so how do we know what the stars and all the astrophysical objects and the sky, the sun, what they're like, what they're made of, what temperature they are, what density they are? We have to use the radiation that comes from them. And in particular, the spectra that comes from them is very useful to us in telling us what they're made from and what the nature is. And this is my speciality. I've specialized in the solar spectrum and worked most of my life in that area. So, for example, if we look at the spectral lines which are emitted by different gases, we can see that they have different natures. It's a little bit like fingerprints or a little bit like the swipe thing on something you buy in a supermarket or wherever you go. That bar chart tells you what the gas is made of. It also gives you a lot of other information which we can glean from it. Helium. This is an image of the sun in helium from Skylab. You can see, hopefully, a huge explosion on the side of the sun. Helium was first discovered on the sun way before it was actually discovered here on Earth. Helium is named after the sun, Helios. Greek word for the sun. How many of you have seen a total eclipse of the sun? Ah, yeah, I've seen one too. I'm all right on that score. I would like to see another, but I'm not sure I'm going to actually get to see it. But yeah, this year, there's one going right across the USA, as I'm sure many of you know. So during a total eclipse of the sun, the main light from the sun in the visible is blocked out. The disk, during a total eclipse, during an annual eclipse, it's not totally blocked out, but during a total eclipse, the moon is exactly the right angular size to block out the light, the visible light that comes from the disk of the sun. And that is about a million times brighter than the light that we see coming from the solar atmosphere, crown of light, or corona. So basically, we only see the corona from Earth in this beautiful way during a total eclipse of the sun. It is, for those of you that have not seen it, it is the most amazing experience, not just from what you see, but from what you feel and how eerie it is when the sun starts to go out in the middle of the day. Even for us solar physicists who know exactly what's going on, it makes you feel a little bit, ooh. Yeah, so if you get the opportunity, it goes cool, it goes, the wind gets up a little bit. If you get the opportunity, do try and see a total eclipse of the sun. Now, if we use a spectrometer during a total eclipse of the sun, as they did quite early on, for example, in 1861, they saw some spectral lines. This is plotted in slightly different. This is brightness as a function of wavelengths in nanometers. But they saw some very strong lines. They saw the green line, yellow line, and the red line, and various other spectral lines, which they couldn't explain by any of the known elements. It didn't fit in the patterns of any of the known elements. So, you know, scientific theories, somebody thought, well, we had such a lot of success with helium, let's invent something called coronium. You know, that's a great idea, but it was one of those scientific theories that didn't really go anywhere because they couldn't fit it into the pattern of the other elements. And it took a lot of very detailed laboratory work and in extrapolations to actually work out what these lines were due to. And these lines were actually due to iron. The green line is due to iron, which would normally have 26 electrons orbiting around, but actually the temperature is so hot that these atoms have bumped into each other and 13 of those electrons have actually got stripped off the iron. So we end up with, we like to confuse people. The atomic physics people call it Fe plus 13 and the spectroscopists call it Fe 14. So, you know, language issues are always difficult in science. But basically, to obtain that amount of ionization of the atom, you need to reach temperatures of a million degrees. So that corona that we're seeing during the total eclipse is actually a million degrees. Whereas if some of you saw one of the first slides I put up, the surface of the sun is only around about 6,000 degrees. So that was a big surprise. It wasn't expected. And it was difficult to explain. It still is difficult to explain, I have to say. But we do have a few ideas as to why that might be. We're closer now. We like to think with research that we progress. So we do hope that we are a little closer now to understanding why that is. I want to mention this man, Edelin, who did the very careful laboratory work in Sweden and was the person who identified these coronal lines, along with Grotian, who also noticed the pattern. So sometimes there's a very strong link between the astrophysical observations and the laboratory work, and this is particularly true in spectroscopy, where we depend a lot on laboratory work to get wavelengths. However, we can't necessarily reproduce all of the conditions that are there on the sun, the very high temperatures that we get on the sun. And in fact, this work was done by extrapolation. He was able to identify the red line was due to iron, which has 9 electrons missing, and the green line was due to iron, which has 13 electrons stripped off. Now, these lines are very important to me personally, because as a graduate student, this is what I was given to work on. So I did my BSc, as I said, with Ian at Queen Mary College, where we had a very happy few years, I think. not just because of Ian, but, you know, in general. And then I did my PhD at University College. And I wanted to acknowledge my supervisor, Professor Mike Seaton, who was the president of the Royal Astronomical Society. He had a big group there looking at atomic data and applying that to different astrophysical objects. And he gave me a paper, an eclipse paper from 1952. I didn't see that eclipse, I hasten to add, which he wanted me to analyze those coronal visible lines. And I had to do some calculations, and I was able to do the first calculations, with accurate calculations, which enabled people to analyze those coronal visible lines. The other person I wanted to mention was Dr. Alan Burgess, who was sadly no longer with us, but was at the Department of Applied Mathematics and Theoretical Physics, and he was the person that I came to work with in Cambridge many years ago, and was a key person with regard to understanding the solar corona, or the atomic processes going on there. So the corona is very hot, and because it is very hot, it emits very strongly in ultraviolet light and in X-rays. And this is an image from a Japanese satellite called Yoko, an old one, in which you can see the X-ray emission from the sun. And you'll see it's very different from when we look at the sun in the visible. We can see these coronal holes here, which are the source of the fast solar wind. We can see areas which are very bright, and these are active regions. This is where the sunspots are. And in fact, we can see a variety of features all over the sun. So if we look at solar minimum to solar maximum, we can see how this X-ray emission changes from solar minimum to solar maximum. Although the visible light doesn't change dramatically during the solar cycle, the X-ray light and the ultraviolet light does change quite dramatically. So, I was a co-investigator on the SOHO spacecraft, and the instrument that I was working on was a spectrometer led by the Rutherford Appleton Laboratory. SOHO was probably one of the greatest observatories that we've had. It was used to study the solar interior, the solar atmosphere, and the solar wind. And Ian showed you an old image from SOHO this morning. I'm going to show you some more. But actually, that coronagraph is the only one still operating. So we're still using that coronagraph. Some of the other instruments are now redundant because we have better instruments that see with better resolution. But it was launched over 20 years ago, and I was involved with it before launch in the design of some of the instruments. We wanted to address particular scientific objectives, so I worked with the team at Rutherford to do that. But it's still operating, and as I say, some of the instruments have been replaced because they're no longer needed. They're just in a low mode. Some of them have been switched off, but some of them are still being used. So I'm hoping that this movie is going to work. Yes. Sorry, we tried out the movies earlier on. This is the green sun, as opposed to the blue sun. But this is an ultraviolet image from the EUV imaging telescope on SOHO. And we're looking at a narrow band, a wavelength band, which is sensitive to an iron line, and which is has a characteristic of about a million degrees. So what you're seeing here is the solar corona at about a million degrees. And you can see, even looking at that, how dynamic it is. When I worked at Goddard with the team at Goddard, SOHO was operated from Goddard Space Flight Center, and I worked there quite a lot. And when I first saw these images on the screen, on a proper screen, a plasma screen, they were stunning. It was like as if there were little diamonds all over the sun. It was just incredible, amazing. So here we can compare the ultraviolet sun at solar minimum, or close to solar minimum, and at solar maximum. And we can see that the ultraviolet sun is quite different, just as the X-ray sun is quite different. One of the instruments on SOHO is able to look at the solar surface, measure the magnetic field on the solar surface. And here we can see the magnetic field on the solar surface, positive and negative, and we can see these are the regions, the active regions, where the sunspots are, but it's peppered all over with positive and negative. And Just beneath the surface, there is convection happening, and that convection is bringing the magnetic field to the surface and churning it up. In fact, that small-scale structure changes every 2 days, and that was something that SOHO, we were amazed when we found that out. So we could take equations and take the surface magnetic field and extrapolate what we think the magnetic field looks like from the just measuring it on the surface, and we can see it's very complicated, and it's constantly changing and moving. If we took, for example, a large active region loop, the structure here, this is from another instrument called TRACE, which is again in the ultraviolet, but here, and this is the edge of the sun, here we can see these large loops of hot plasma. The plasma is ionized, it traces out the magnetic field. So we're able to see basically what the magnetic field looks like from this ionized plasma. And here we can see it's just as if there's a bar magnet there. And it's popping up through the surface. The sunspots are where this magnetic field pops up through the surface. Now let's see if this one works. Are you going to work? Takes a minute to think about it. I hope it's going to work. I'll click it, see if it works then. Might crash the whole system. Yeah, there you go. Takes a little while because there's quite big movies. So this is now more recent. This is the Solar Dynamics Observatory, which, as I said, is a more recent observatory. We call it our eye on the sun because it takes images every 12 seconds in a variety of wavelength bands. And this is one of the bands where you can see this beautiful active region rotating round. So you're seeing million degree plasma there. So we have different questions. We look at an active region and we want to understand the structure of the active region. And there are different parts of it. There's these large loops we can see quite clearly at a million degrees. There are hot core loops which are bubbling up and they're a little bit hotter. They're about 3 million degrees. Maybe they even have microflare activity, so small flares happening in those cores. And then we see some very large loops called fan loops, which we think may either go to other areas on the sun or may actually connect in with the solar wind. This is another recent instrument that I've worked on, and the PI group for the instrument, the spectrometer. They had this is a joint NASA, Japanese, ESA, UK mission, and three instruments, X-ray telescope, EUV spectrometer and an optical telescope looking at the surface, and it's looking at connections between what's happening on the surface and what's happening higher up in the solar atmosphere. And the instrument that I worked on is the EUV imaging spectrometer, because I'm a specialist in spectra, and this is led by the group at Mallard Space Science Laboratory in part of University College London, and the PI there is Louise Hara. She's now leading one of the major instruments on Solar Orbiter, which is due for launch in 2018. Imaging instruments are great, and we can see the whole sun, and we can get pictures every 12 seconds or whatever. But spectrometers, they're more complex instruments in the sense that we have to scan an area with a slit. So we take a long slit, and each position on that slit, we can get a spectra, but we have to scan an area, and sometimes that takes time. So most of our progress has been made by combining imaging instruments with spectrometers. So we can use the imaging instruments to see the context of what we're looking at and how things are changing, and then we can use a spectrometer to get all the details and quantitative results from it. How do we do this? Well, in order to understand the spectra, we need to do a lot of atomic physics in the background. And as I say, that was where my background was in. But over 20 years ago now, we put together an atomic database called Chianti, a collaboration, again, between Italy, the UK, and I choose my collaborators very carefully, and the people in the USA. And I think if you look carefully, you can probably see Galileo's house in the background. This is shot at our Arcetri Observatory. We came together as a collaboration to gather all of the atomic physics, and I'm not going to go into the details of the atomic physics. There's a lot of atomic physics you need to know to understand the intensities of these spectral lines. So we put together a package called Chianti, which you can use. We get all the latest publications, we do a lot of calculations ourselves, and then people can use this to interpret the spectra. And this is now universally used by all of solar physics and used a tremendous amount in astronomy as well. And here we've got an example from the ICE instrument of the variety of spectral lines we see. This is now in angstroms, from 170 to 284 angstroms. And we can see a variety of different elements and different ionization stages. So it's quite complicated to interpret what we're seeing. If we took one particular spectral line, for example, and this is just iron 12, so 11 times ionized, and it's formed at about 2 million degrees, we can see this is a raster, we can get information intensity. We can see Doppler shifts, so we can get the Doppler motions, and we can look at the width of the line. But we can also do other things. We can use particular spectral lines to get the electron density. We can look at sequence of ions to get the temperature. Here is an example from ICE of the solar maximum and solar minimum in some of the spectral lines, some of the coronal lines. And again, you can see the big difference between solar minimum over here, solar maximum here. This is a line which is sensitive to about maybe 3 million degrees, and here you can see at solar maximum and at solar minimum. In order to, Ian was talking this morning about big data, and in solar physics also, we're dealing with big data. In fact, on the satellites, one of our biggest constraints is the data download. We've got a lot more information actually up there than we can bring down and handle because of the data rates. And it's as if you've got a photograph, maybe an old school photograph or something like that, and you have to decide, you know, which person you're going to bring down or which bit you're going to bring down. So there are various parameters we have to put in when we have to create what we call an observing sequence. We have to decide where we're going to point, first of all, because we can't take the whole sun, we can only take a small area. We need to consider what the exposure rate might be. We need to consider what spectral lines we might want to bring down, which parts of the data we want to bring down. So we have to do this in advance, and we have to create a particular study which is fine-tuned to the science that we want to try and get out of it. And then we have to look and see if it works afterwards. So this is just one example. Here's the limb of the sun here, and we're looking at this active region, which is on the limb of the sun. And we've chosen, this is with one of the students of mine, Brendan, we've chosen to study that active region. And from the data we've got, what we're able to do is to get a density map. This is electron number density on this side. We're able to get a density map from looking at some of the spectral lines, and we're able to get a temperature map. So this is temperatures going up to, on the log scale, 6.7, so quite high temperatures in the core. So we're able to map out some of these parameters which are required to feed into the models, or for the models to predict, to see whether the models are working or not. So I talked about the Doppler shift. I'm sure you're probably familiar with it, but if the plasma is moving, then the line is shifted, blue shifted towards us or red shifted away from us. And with the instrument on Hinode, this was one of the magical things that we found. It probably been seen before, but not as consistently as we found here. If we took an image of the active region, we saw these huge blue areas, which is plasma moving towards us, and then we saw red regions where the plasma is actually condensing down in these coronal loops. Now, we have various models. One of them is called interchange reconnection, why we think that might be happening. And one of the questions we're addressing is whether or not this blue region here is coming right out into the solar wind, whether that is contributing towards the slow solar wind or not. So one of the really important processes which happens in the solar atmosphere and also in the Earth's environment, in the magnetosphere and elsewhere, is something called magnetic reconnections, where the magnetic fields reconnect. They change their form. And when they do that, they like to be in a low energy state. If they get twisted up, or if they get disturbed, they like to reconnect into a lower energy state. When they do that, magnetic energy is transferred into thermal energy, heat, and into kinetic energy. Now, this can happen on small scales, or this can happen on very large scales. So, smaller scales, nanoflares, for example, happening on small scales, and large scales, really big solar flares. So we believe that this process is really important in the solar corona, and the reason they get twisted up is because beneath the surface, a convection zone is twisting them up, and magnetic field is erupting from beneath the solar surface, disturbing an overlying field. So here, this is a very famous scientist called Parker, who's done a tremendous amount of work in this field and many other fields. And his theory was that if you straighten out this loop, for example, but you twist up the foot points, what you end up with is lots of strands that are all twisted up. And what happens is the magnetic field doesn't like to be in that state, and it reconnects in many different strands or in many different positions here. And as it reconnects at each point, maybe a nanoflare, maybe a small amount of energy, but it adds up. So basically, we think that this process is quite important in channeling energy up from beneath the surface into the corona. So energy is channeled up in these magnetic fields, and then it's released up in the corona with as thermal energy and kinetic energy. Now, we can look at, and we've had a whole series of workshops on active regions. The last one was in Cambridge 2 years ago, hosted by us in DAMPT. And we can look at theoretical models for this heating and what that might imply for the plasmas, the plasma properties we might be able to measure. For example, this is the emission measure, which is the amount of material, basically the amount of material at different temperatures and how that changes over time. So if we had what we call weak impulsive, that's just a small amount of nanoflaring every so often, then we might expect the amount of material to look something like this. But if we have strong nanoflaring, that's a lot going off, then we might expect it to look a little different. So people are working on this theoretically, predicting what might happen if we release energy in different ways. And then it's our job really to see what the data looks like and to compare that with the data. So we've got another meeting coming up, in Italy. This year, so we'll again come together and argue and discuss as to whose model is best reproduces what we're seeing. I've mentioned this instrument several times now, Solar Dynamics Observatory, and the instrument that I'm focusing on mainly is this AIA, Atmospheric Imaging Assembly. As I say, it produces an image every 12 seconds. Now, at the beginning there, I showed you an image of the sun today, and you can go on to SDO, the sun today. If you just Google that, you'll find a site at Goddard, and you can see images from SDO that are put up there very frequently in different wavelength bands. So it has lots of different channels. It can see different wavelength bands, which are sensitive to different temperatures. It has an extremely good spatial resolution. So we have an extremely good spatial resolution. We have the full sun, and we have it every 12 seconds. Huge amounts of data. So if that moves on, is it going to move on? Yeah, there we go. Here you can see the different channels that we have. So we can see different temperature regimes from 5,000 degrees, 100,000 degrees, a million degrees, right up to flaring channels, which pick up, and they're picking up spectral lines, which are very highly ionized. We can superpose this, and we can get the temperature structure of the regions that we're looking at. So this is a very powerful instrument. We get all of this simultaneously, and every 12 seconds, huge amounts of data. So here's just to show you as an example what happens with the image I showed at the beginning. In this image is we've taken three bands and superimposed them to bring out the blue. The dark blue is the cooler, and then the yellow and red is the hotter. And here you can see a sunspot group, and here you can see these beautiful loops of hot coronal emission joining that sunspot. So now I've talked a little bit about the active regions and some theories. Waves could also be important in transferring energy, and we're looking at waves, and that might give us a different signature for the parameters that we measure. But I'm going to move on a little bit to solar flares. So here's a picture way back. It's a colleague of mine, George Doshek, who I've worked with for many years at the Naval Research Laboratory, and we worked on Skylab, we worked on solar maximum emission, and we worked on the Hinode spectrometer also. We've worked on many different things, but one of the things we've worked on is solar flares. Solar maximum emission had an X-ray, had X-ray instruments on it, very good X-ray instruments. Sadly, in our solar observations, we've been negligent in the X-ray wavelength regions. We haven't had very good X-ray spectrometers recently, and it's one of the things we would love to have because they provide very hot lines, maybe 10 million degree lines. Now, the standard model of a solar flare is that we get ejection of material, we get reconnection happening here. The particles are accelerated, they hit down here in the chromosphere, they lower it down, heat it up, and then we get hot material evaporating up into these loops. So one of our goals is to try and understand that in detail and see how the observations might confirm that standard two-dimensional model. Now, here I think it went quite quickly, but this is an image from SOHO again, and we can see a flare. We can see it's this little box here is blow up of the central region, and we can see a huge amount of energy, huge amount of radiation emitted in a very short time scale. Here we can see if we're here we can see an eruption taking place on the edge of the sun in different channels of Solar Dynamics Observatory. And afterwards, we get some loops growing there. And here, to be a little bit patient, it takes a little minute to come up. But the time is running here. And in this box here, it shows at different temperatures from Solar Dynamics Observatory, a flare taking place. And then there we can see a flare taking place. This is just burnout on the detectors that's so bright, it just bleeds the detectors. And that's a problem for us, because quite often the instruments saturate and we can't actually use that data. So we can classify flares to different groups, and they're classified by the amount of X-ray radiation that they give out. So this goes, instrument measures the X-ray radiation, and we classify A, B, C, M, moderate, and X. Things are never simple. So we've studied quite a lot of small flares because we don't want our instruments to be saturated, but an X-class flare is a really big flare. And that doesn't happen very frequently. You can then subdivide that into X1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or whatever you want to do. Same with M and C. Okay, so here I think if it's running, is it running? Maybe that one's not going to run for us. I'll give it a click and see if I can make it run. Might crash it all. Oh, there we go. Just took a little bit of time. That's an X-class flare, one of the ones that we've seen with the Solar Dynamics Observatory. And after the initial flash, and you might have seen some material moving off, then we get huge loops of very hot emission, 10 million degree emission, which then cools down to cooler temperatures forming underneath it. Now, we know from the records that Carrington and Hodgson saw a very large flare in 1859. Now, we didn't have X-ray emission at that time, so we can't classify it, but we know from the effects that it had on here on Earth that it was an X-class and it was very big. This is another X-class that's seen by Solar Dynamics Observatory. And the concern is that, of course, these X-class flares can be problematic for technology Carrington's day, the technology wasn't that great. But now we depend a lot on technology. So we need to understand what creates these flares, what the build-up is. We need to learn a little bit more about them, because if we did have a big flare like that, there are certain things we can do to protect some of the technology. One of the precursors that we might see to a flare is a very strange thing. It's an S shape in the X-rays. You can see the X-ray. Call it a sigmoid. I don't know. I think somebody said that was a biological something or other. I didn't go into too much details there, but it's an S shape basically in the X-rays. So that this is reverse colour. So a dark is bright, and this indicates S marks the spot indicates where we might be going to have a solar flare happen. Now, why? This is because what's happening in this region is the magnetic field is getting really twisted up. So we know that as the region gets more complex, the footprints are moving, things are moving, and the magnetic field gets twisted up. So it gets twisted up into this rather strange S shape. And then it's emerging through the surface of the sun, and it's all twisted up. And this is when reconnection takes place, and basically we get this enormous release of energy. So here, if you look carefully beforehand, you can probably see the twists there, and then afterwards, this is in the ultraviolet, the solar limb is here, we get these huge loops of hot gas forming. So if we look at that standard model again in a slightly different format, what we have is eruption of what we call this flux rope that's come up from beneath the surface. That erupts out. There's reconnection taking place here and fast particles being accelerated down into the footprints. Now, we can see really high energy particles with another instrument called RESI, which looks at very high energy X-rays. And we're able to identify where that energy release takes place and where it impacts on the footprint regions. So here's hard X-ray sources in the footprint regions. The release has taken place here. So we're really keen to catch this, and it's very difficult to catch a flare. With solar maximum mission, which was orbiting the Earth, inevitably the solar flare happened when the satellite was on the other side of the Earth and couldn't see the sun. SOHO, I didn't explain. SOHO's in an orbit that actually goes around the sun. So SOHO, in fact, sees the sun 24 hours a day. So with a bit of luck, this might work. If not, I'll give it a bit of a kick and see if that helps. Okay, there you go. That kick started it, I think. And here we can see a solar flare that we studied more recently with the Solar Dynamics Observatory, and we can see it in a lot more detail. I won't go into all of the details, but this is very high temperature emission. This is 10 million degrees. And we see very complex structures. We now have models which are not just two-dimensional, but are now three-dimensional. Now, what has happened over the past decade or so is computers have improved. The data that we get has improved. But also, it's been possible to build more sophisticated models, you know, better resolution, and from going from two dimensions, just sketches, to three-dimensional models. So this is a flare that we've actually compared with some of these three-dimensional. We call this slipping reconnection. It's now in three-dimensional. Some of the models from colleagues over in France that we're working with. And we were able, this was the first confirmation that the model that they had proposed was actually a realistic model. So from the ratio of the AIA channels, if we take two AIA channels, we're able to get a temperature, and it's very interesting to track the very high temperatures. So if we take, and using Chianti, of course, as we always do, if we take two of the channels, we're able to get the ratio as a function of temperature. And here we can see a structure in which we're connecting a lower loop with a higher loop, and we can see very high temperatures forming at that region where we think reconnection is taking place. Again, we're not an expert in everything. We've got modelers, the Mallard Space Science Laboratory, which are modeling this whole structure and how it develops. This is a recent paper with my research student, Vanessa, in which we're looking at recurrence of flares and comparing those with models. One of the really interesting spectrometers is probably not one that you've heard of, but what this spectrometer does, it's run by NASA, our colleagues in NASA, it actually combines a slit with an imaging at the same time. So we have an image of the region and we have a slit cutting across it. So from the slit, we're able to get the quantitative information, and from the image, we're able to see what's happening. So this is really exciting for us. There was an instrument flown long ago by the Naval Research Laboratory called Hertz, which did a similar thing. But we're able to look at a sequence of spectral lines, but we're able to know exactly where they are. For example, in this case, they're cutting one of the ribbons of a solar flare. So we've recently been doing a lot of work with this spectrometer. As I said, we have to work in a team, and we also have to celebrate from time to time. So this is over at the Center for Astrophysics in Harvard, where we're working with the team there. So my student here, Vanessa, who's hiding a little bit in the background, is now finished her PhD, and she's working with Kathy at Harvard and over at Lockheed. So and Yaroslav here has done a lot of work on non-equilibrium processes, which I'm not going to go into the details of. I'm conscious of the time, but I just want to quickly say a little bit about the coronal mass ejections. Ian showed you an image from SOHO. The sun is blocked out here. And really, this has been an amazing observatory for looking at these ejections, vast ejections of material from the sun, together with stereo, which I'm not going to talk about here. Solar Dynamics Observatory has also seen huge explosions on the sun and ejections of material. Sometimes these fall back, but sometimes these are ejected off into space. Here is an example from SOHO. The sun is blocked out, and here we saw a comet, and here we can see an ejection of material from the SOHO spacecraft. In this particular instance, we've superimposed the sun on top. The sun is blocked out, but you can see something rising from the sun in helium and then moving out, blasting out into space. Now, these are interesting, okay? But why do we care? Well, occasionally, one of these comes towards us. Now, SOHO is between us and the sun. It's about a hundredth of the way between us and the sun. This is hitting SOHO. That's what all that snow is. It's hit the detectors on SOHO. If it's hitting SOHO, it's going to hit us. And then, of course, we care. And this is called space weather. It's an area in which we're all contributing from regard of understanding what's happening on the sun, understanding the processes between the sun and the Earth, the solar wind, and how that interacts with the Earth's environment. We're very fortunate that we're protected by our own magnetic field. This gas that's coming, this plasma that's coming off from the sun is ionized, and much of it scoots around our shield. But some of it can interact with the magnetic field around the Earth, and it can disturb the Earth's magnetic field. And when it disturbs the Earth's magnetic field reconnects at the back here and changes its form and accelerates a lot of particles. And it's those particles heading towards the polar regions which cause the beautiful northern lights and can be disruptive to satellites, astronauts in space, International Space Station, for example. When Tim Peake was doing his spacewalk, they had to check to see if it was a likelihood to be a solar explosion or a solar flare beforehand, because the astronauts are very vulnerable when they're out in space. It can cause electricity blackouts and affect polar flights. So what's happening now with the sunspot cycle? Well, we've got some solar telescopes out the back, and if the sun appears again, I did have a look through one earlier on today, and we have got a couple of little sunspots, but actually, this is where we are now. We're coming down here into a quieter period. This maxima hasn't been as large and as exciting as we solar physicists would like it to have been. It could have been a few more flares and a few more exciting events. So this is the last few solar cycles, so coming up to 216, 217 up here. The image at the back is a Yoko image. Now, before I end, because I'm running out of time, I wanted to tell you about some of the work that I've been doing outreach-wise. We do have a website called SunTrek. It's about SOHO primarily. It was set up quite a while ago, but it does have links to more recent information. It does need a lot of work and a lot of updating. But sadly, there aren't enough hours in the day, but we're doing our best. So we set it up maybe 10, 20 years ago, but it does have links to some interesting images and movies and information about the sun. I worked a lot on the Tim Peake project with the schools in the UK. That was a marvellous opportunity called Principia. And I worked with many schools here in the UK, mostly primary schools, engaging them with what was happening in space, how you live in space, how you work in space, thinking about future travel to Mars, etc. Tim Peake was very supportive of Principia and of the project that I worked on, which was called the Space to Earth Challenge. But now we're taking that a stage further. We want to have a legacy. So what we're doing is I'm now an SDSC Public Engagement Fellow, and I'm taking the work that I've done on the sun and the so beautiful solar images and astronomical images as well. And we're combining science with arts in primary schools. So we've got artists, professional artists working with us, and we're going into schools and we're inspiring children about the beauty of astronomy. And I'm sure many of you here have been captivated by astronomy and in awe of it as we are. So the results so far are very good. We've had very good feedback. I mean, one child wrote, this was the best day of my life. It's fine. Don't know what the rest of the life had been like. But anyway, we're working in rural schools. That was a rural school in one of the areas of Wales that is an old mining town. But the kids are having a fantastic time. And at the same time, we are engaging them with science when they aren't all necessarily switched on by it. So some of the very useful feedback is, oh, I didn't know science could be so interesting. Sorry. Computers. And here is some of the work. So we're not, as I say, we're not just doing the sun. Here's a galaxy. There's a galaxy, Ian, in case you didn't recognize it. Not sure which one. But sun and space and aurora. So I think that's about me finished, I think. I have it about done, if I can move on to the next slide, but maybe not. She doesn't want to move on. There we go. That's it. Me done.
Thanks very much, Helen. That was a great exposition of interplay between fabulous experiments, really complex data analysis and really bright theory in terms of that. I clearly feel I've missed out on this. You know, solar physicists clearly drink more than the rest of us. I'm sure that. Questions from the audience. We'll start at the back, just straight up there.
Do we know why the solar cycle from maximum to maximum is 11 years and why this one in particular is smaller than some of
the I don't know why it's 11 years. We know why it's caused, because the magnetic field is formed beneath the surface of the sun in what we call the tachocline, which is between the radiative zone and the convective zone. It's formed there and it erupts up through the surface. And because the sun is rotating differentially, it's rotating faster at the equator than the poles, the magnetic field gets twisted around and then erupts up through the surface, forming the active regions, and then gets dissipated gradually and then starts again. Why 11 years? I don't know. I don't know the answer to that, and I don't know whether anybody does. I think that it's something that people are studying, perhaps by looking at other stars and other cycles as well, considering their rotation rate, considering their activity, their flares, to try and understand, you know, why the 11 years. Why is this one smaller? Well, Nigel Weiss, who works in my group, not in my group, but in my department, he's part of the solar group there, is now retired. He's spent a lot of time studying the dynamo and the solar cycle. And I think there's an overall pattern for the, there's an 11-year cycle, but there are other scales of patterns of cycles. So it's not just the 11 years. And I think that he can give some form of explanation when the sun changes from a dipole, it goes through a quadrupole, and it may have other phases. So we can see a pattern in it, and there are other people in Boulder that are modelling this in great detail with huge numerical simulations. But I have to say, Nigel Weiss on the back of an envelope can reproduce what they're doing to a certain extent.
Okay,
we'll
follow. Given the current state of
instrumentation,
computational capabilities, What proportion of stars is it possible to observe similar major structures and phenomena?
That's probably a question for an astronomer. I think XMM's done a lot of work, for example, with solar flare observations, so we can. You want to know how many stars, what proportion of stars we can observe in this detail, was it, or in this?
Not necessarily that amount of detail, but be able to actually see things like flares.
We can see flares with the X-ray, say XMM, other instruments. ROSAC could. We can see flare stars. We can't obviously see the detail, but we can. Some of the other UV instruments have been amazing. So we can see, we can study the spectra, and we can see other stars in a similar way, but obviously not in the sort of detail that we can see the sun. But I don't know what fraction. It depends how close they are, I guess, how well we can see them.
I've found a whole pile, but you now know the sun is not unique, and many stars do have flares, particularly G-type stars. Okay, there's another one back there.
Do we know if Galileo observed the sun directly or did he project it?
No, I understand. People get confused because Galileo did go blind. But I think that was not because he was looking at the sun. In fact, I think it was congenital or something like that. But I believe he projected it. And in fact, there's Seven Ages of Starlight, which is a program that I participated in, doing the sun. It's been on the TV several times. This is an advert. Very good series. We actually reproduced the way in which Galileo projected his images using one of the telescopes here at the Institute of Astronomy. Obviously, he didn't use that one. But we were able to, show in the way in which Galileo would have projected the images and drawn the sunspots. And the Royal Greenwich Observatory, of course, has got a whole archive of sunspots as well, and other places.
Time for more questions. Yes, the middle there.
You showed a lot of things where the iron lines in particular were being used as proxies for the temperature.
Yep.
Maybe I misunderstood, but it seemed to be that for 1 million Kelvin, you were using a more ionized state than for 2 million Kelvin. Is that right?
No. The hotter the temperature gets, the more ionized it is. So 1 million would have been iron 9 and 10, and then 2 would have been iron 11 or higher. I should explain that although I've talked a lot about the iron lines because they're my favorite, I like them, there are only trace elements in the sun. The sun is predominantly hydrogen and helium, and the iron and the oxygen and the carbon, etc., are just trace elements in it. They're not the major component. But they are extremely useful trace elements because they do enable us to determine information about the sun.
Well, I'll use my prerogative and ask a last question. Chianti.
Yeah.
Is it an acronym, or is it just because you like Italy and the drink?
I'm sad to say, I could have called it Sauvignon Blanc or something, because I'm not that keen on Chianti. But actually, no, it was because the way in which the whole thing was perceived was with a colleague of mine, Brunella, a colleague from Italy, and Brunella Monsignor Frassi, and a colleague from the States, and we were in a very beautiful Italian place at the time. We probably had a bottle of Chianti on the table. Sadly, Brunella is no longer with us. She's no longer part of the team. But no, we tried very hard to find an acronym that would be appropriate, but we thought, this is ridiculous. It's just called Chianti, and we hope that because it's got a nice name, people will use it. And it has worked, I have to say.
It's nice. Okay, I think with that, we'll thank Helen for the presentation.